I think we may start, sir. It is very good.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all the attendees of this webinar. I hope I am audible. I'm audible, Vikas?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. So, welcome to this another session by Indian Association of Structural Engineers, a webinar on wind engineering for short and medium span bridges. It's a Sunday afternoon and many of us might be struggling to remain awake till 4 o'clock or must have had a good nap after the lunch. With a cup of tea, you are ready to enjoy the webinar, to have a technical treat on the very well chosen subject, wind engineering for short and medium span bridges. Thanks to GCFIA Structi for putting me here as moderator, and my privilege to introduce all the participants to IA Structi, though most of us are members or know about this, but I'm sure that this webinar is being broadcast all across India and maybe abroad also at some places. IA Structi is a body of professional structural engineers working for the fraternity with the objective to strengthen the knowledge base and to function as an influential think tank for future growth of structural engineers. General public is benefited from IA Structi since they get a safe and well-designed infrastructure provided by qualified and skilled members of the association. This has a knock-on effect benefiting the economy by providing employers with competent specialist professionals. Public benefit is also gained from the ongoing professional support provided to members by conducting CPD courses to keep their knowledge and skills up to date and relevant. IA Structi has organized several webinars on various topics, well chosen with the relevant areas, and expert speakers from the field have been invited to share their knowledge for the benefit of all the structural engineers and young civil engineers as well. So welcome once again, and our today's speaker, Dr. Lakshmi Parmeshwaran, I'll just give a brief about her. She holds a PhD in civil engineering from IIT Roorkee and has more than 33 years of professional experience, which includes research, teaching, and consultancy. Currently, she is a chief scientist at Bridge Engineering and Structures Division of CSIR CRRI, Central Road Research Institute, New Delhi, and professor of engineering science at ACSIR. Her area of research includes wind engineering, bridge engineering, and sustainable construction materials. She has successfully completed aerodynamic studies on cable stayed bridges, wind tunnel studies on chimneys, cooling towers, microwave tower, and designed many wind sensitive communication and TV towers. She has immensely contributed to the development of bridge maintenance management system in CRRI, mobile bridge inspection unit, structural health monitoring of bridges, distress diagnostics and rehabilitation of bridges. She has authored more than 120 technical papers, published in national and international journals and conferences. She was a visiting scholar at Johns Hopkins University at USA. She is also a recipient of BIOCOS Fellowship from DST, ING IABAC Best Paper Award, Indian National Group of International Association of Bridge and Structural Engineers, and commendation certificate from Institution of Engineers India. She is a member of various IRC and BIS committees and significantly contributed to the drafting of various code of practices and guidelines for bridge design, construction, and maintenance management. With this, I would invite Dr. Lakshmi Parmeshwaran, but before that, I'll make one more announcement that next webinar is on the long span bridges, wind engineering for long span bridges by Dr. K. Suresh from RWDI, Trivandrum, India. And Alok Bhaumik would be the moderator there. So you all can register for that once the announcement has been made. This will be live. There will be live streaming of this webinar on YouTube, and link will be shared soon in the chat box right now when the presentation goes. You can post your questions, queries in the Q&A chat, Q&A box, while other comments you can put in the chat box. Avoid putting questions in the chat box. Just put them on the Q&A box only. And we will take up them all at the end of the webinar. So madam will take around 1 hour time for her presentation, and then we will have the question answer. So I invite Dr. Lakshmi Parmeshwaran to share her screen and start the presentation. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Abhay Gupta. I'm just sharing my screen. I hope it is clear.
It is clear.
And also I am audible.
Well audible.
Very good afternoon, all of you. My topic of today's presentation is BIMP engineering for short and medium span bridges. In my presentation, I will be discussing about the types of wind in India, the characteristics, the effect of terrain and topography, and briefly talking about the static and dynamic wind effects which are required for the bridge design. And I'll be presenting a case study of wind tunnel test. Then the wind clause in IRC6, which are now being used for the design of this short and medium span bridges. They are almost like 12, 13 years old. And we are in the process of revising these clauses. So I'll be focusing on this aspect and the likely changes which are there, that also will be discussed. And here I want to mention that, like, there is a guideline from NDMA where we have to follow, like, the basic wind speed map and all other aspects which are covered in BIS standards. So we will be doing it in line with what is given in IS 875 part 3, 2015. So moving to the introduction, you all know that bridges are very, very important structural elements, both in road and railway network. And it depends, it is required for the economic development and socio-economic development of the country. And generally they are designed considering the safety and durability aspects, and wind load is one of the lateral load which is to be considered for the design. So there is always a challenge before the designer, whether it is the wind or it is the earthquake which is going to govern the design. And with respect to the seismic effect, again, like IS 1893 is there, and the seismic map is given there, that has been introduced in IRC SP 114, which is the latest guideline for the design of seismic design of bridges. But we are more concerned when we talk about the earthquake, about the pier, because we want that the damage can happen in the pier and not on the deck. So we always think about the plastic hinge formation at the pier, and also about the ductile detailing of the pier with respect to the seismic aspect. So that means we are concerned about the transverse and the longitudinal movement of the pier, which is having a deck over it. But with respect to the wind, we are more concerned about the bridge deck as such, its vertical vibration or lateral vibration, or pier as such, it's again longitudinal or transverse vibration. So these are some of the aspects which are of importance to us. Now, natural calamities like cyclones, they can cause failure of bridge. And collapse of such structures, they cause loss of human lives, disruption of transport network, affects the economy. So we don't want such things to happen. So we have to be careful about the taking the appropriate wind forces for the design. I want to share like two bridges, two iconic bridges in India. Like the first one is the Pamban Bridge, which is more than 106 years old. And this survived the Rameshwaram cyclone of 1964, and where the storm surge was something like 7 meters. And you know that this bridge is located at a corrosive environment, and also during the life of the bridge, it was widened, that is from meter gauge to upgraded to broad gauge. So this is one type of bridge which has survived the cyclone, and also it has a basical section which is 12.5 meter above the sea level, the deck, which can be raised for the passage of ships. So this is one example. And another example is the Howrah Bridge or Ravindra Setu, which was constructed and opened to traffic in 1943. And the total length is 705 meter, and it has a width of 21.6 meter, and with 2 footpath on either side, and height of 82 meter. And recent cyclone, this Amphan cyclone of 185 kilometer per hour, which happened in like during May 2020, but this bridge, nothing happened to this bridge. So it will be curious to know how the bridge, these bridges were designed at that time. This again is more than 75 year old bridge. Like what are the wind forces they considered? And also like we have a section, we can apply the wind load to which it was subjected to during the cyclone. And then like we can see the safety of the bridge can be checked. Maybe it will be a curious exercise for a student or a researcher. Now, we cannot forget the Tacoma Narrows Bridge when we talk about any bridge wind engineering. And this bridge made an impact in the history by which like lot of wind engineering studies started, wind tunnel testing started. So this was a suspension bridge, and soon after it was opened to traffic, then there was a maximum twist of one side walk, which was 28 feet higher than the other, and some 600 foot section fell down. And after that, the main side span sagged another 45 feet. But if we just consider, because with respect to the wind engineering of any structure, what matters is the geometric shape as well as the size of the element. And here, as I told you, it is the deck which is of great importance to us. So what were the faults in the bridge design? Actually, there was insufficient stiffness in the deck, which caused vibration, that is the vertical vibration, as well as the swaying. Then width to span ratio, that was only like 1/72. The permissible was of the order of 1/30. Less depth of stiffening girder to span length, it was about 1/348, and minimum permissible was 1/90. And that means the deck was very, very flexible, slender, and it was having very less damping. So the aerodynamic instability, when it has not been taken into account while designing, this was susceptible to vortex shedding. And then like the resonant vibration induced the shedding frequency of vortices coinciding with the natural frequency, and resulting the excessive oscillation, and also like some sort of a torsional flutter also happen, because of which like the amplitude increased drastically, and ultimately it was destroyed. Now, I think you must have seen the Tacoma Narrows video also, how it fails. It is there in the internet as well. And another case of a bridge. This is a bridge in Volgograd in Russia. And in 2010, May 2010, I think this bridge took almost 12, 13 years to complete itself. And in 2010, May, they observed some sort of an oscillation of the vertical vibration to the tune of plus minus 400 millimeter. And you can see that this is a steel concrete composite deck, and the oscillation happened at a low wind speed. And it was mainly vortex induced oscillation, something like at 10, 11, 12 of that order, 11.6 to 15.6 meter. That was the wind velocity recorded on that particular day. And the vortex shedding frequency was in the range of the fundamental vertical frequency, and which led to the vortex-induced oscillation. Actually, like this particular bridge, you can see that it has a deck width of something like 17.56 meter with some cantilevers. You can already see, and deck depth was something of the order of 3.6 meter without the barrier, and with barrier something like 4.82 meter. So the width to depth ratio for the deck, it is of the order of 4.78 to 3.58, and the first bending frequency that was in the vertical direction, that was 0.41, and the third mode something like 0.68. I think I can say that all the three vertical bending frequencies were quite close. But when they observed this, what they did was, first they closed this bridge for the traffic, and then they observed it for 5 days. And then quickly, this 12 semi-active tuned mass dampers of mass 5,200 kg were installed by Maurer, and with the help of EMPA Swiss Federal Lab. So you can see here the semi-active mass dampers which were installed. And with this installation, basically what happened was that this 400 mm oscillation that got reduced to something like 45 to 90 millimeter, that range. So this is a happened almost 10 years back. So a new case where some sort of a wind induced problem has happened. Now, going back to the history of wind engineering in India, basically the wind engineering studies, or we call it industrial aerodynamics, it all relates to the effect of wind on structures which are there on the ground, fixed to the ground, or you can say any non-flying structure, because most of the time the aerodynamics has come from the aerospace engineers to the wind engineers, who are so-called the wind engineers. And in India, it began in 1958, where Indian Institute of Science, who has an aeronautical wind tunnel, low-speed wind tunnel, like they were asked to do the wind tunnel studies on railway platform, as some of these platforms, they got damaged when they were designed using some foreign codes. So they made some study, and then that was the first study done on any structure in India. And traditionally, we think that, okay, wind loading on structure, it is viewed as estimating the dynamic pressure of wind at site and then multiply by some shape factor and characteristic area on which the wind is acting. Like that was given in IS 875 in 1964. But then it was realized that it is the unsteady nature of the wind load and the dynamic response to vortex excitation, galloping, flutter, ovaling. These things are also to be examined depending upon the type of structure you are considering. For example, you have a tall chimney where like this vortex excitation becomes a problem, or like you have a cable stayed bridge deck where there may be some flutter there, or there may be a transmission line cable where the galloping may be a problem when you have a ice cladded transmission line, or maybe a natural draft cooling tower where like you have a thin wall which is subjected to ovaling. So these all these things then subsequently got incorporated in IS 875 Part 3, 1987. Now, the type of wind what we experience in India is different from what the other countries are having. Actually, the classification is done like tropical cyclone, extratropical cyclones, monsoon winds, and in North India, we have the Andhi or the local thunderstorms. Then in some part like the pressure system. The pressure system is the well-behaved type of wind with very little turbulence. But what actually makes the wind pattern in India complex is that most part of the India, the wind is a mix of all the above five mechanisms. So the extreme wind in India are different from like the Western Europe or Canada, where the wind cost is by fully developed pressure system. So the theories on wind loading on structures like developed by Davenport in 1967 or Vickery and Basu in 1984, they all implicitly assume wind to be well-behaved or caused due to pressure system. So that's the reason like we may not be able to blindly follow what is given with respect to the wind climate given in other countries' code. And how then the wind characteristics are measured, that is an important aspect. In India, basically IMD, they measures the wind velocity data, and it is measured at an altitude of 10 meters using Dynet pressure tube anemograph. But there are other countries where they use either propeller or vane anemometer. And some study was done by Professor Sitaramlu of IIT Delhi during 1985 to generate the mean hourly data from IMT measurement. And what he found was that the ratio of the peak gust to the mean hourly wind was practically high at all stations in comparison to the ratio of peak gust to mean high hourly wind speed for region with pressure system as discussed by Professor Davenport. So the mean hourly wind in India, then another problem was also seen. Basically, probably the method by which we measure it, I think the averaging was done for the, not for the entire 1 hour, but only for the last 10 minutes. So whether the whatever hourly, mean hourly wind speed, whether it actually represents that of 1 hour, that was also a great a doubt on that. Then this Mani and Mule in 1983, they did some study where this true full hour mean data was covered. That is, after doing the statistical analysis, they compared with the mean of the last 10 minutes and found something like a 5% difference. Then Professor G.N.V. Rao and his team, they also examined the effect of various average tide in moderate wind at Balasur and concluded that actually for Indian case, like we need a longer time, something like 15 to 20 minutes is required to obtain the steady values. Why I want to say is that we have like in our quotes, like 3 second gust, then hourly mean wind speed given, and some other quotes like transmission line code, etc. They use 10 minute average averaging time. But what exactly the averaging time has to be, that is also a big question mark. And you know that the wind, it is a time varying force. That amplitude is changing with time, and also the wind speed changes with the elevation. And depending on the terrain where like the structure is situated, the boundary layer also will change. And you have something like a 500 meter boundary layer or 300 meter boundary layer, depending on the terrain which is surrounding at a particular location. So to understand basically the response of the wind load, response of a structure to the wind load, we have to understand the wind climate and how it is getting affected because of the terrain or the surrounding topography. Then about the structure, basically it is the geometric shape, very, very important, the size of the structure and the dynamic properties of the structure. So these are very, very important for a designer per se. Now coming back to the type of winds like cyclones, thunderstorm and tornadoes, what we have, basically we have to understand that like apart from the high wind speed, the turbulence characteristics at that time, they are also changing. So if you see the cyclones, basically they are the vortices having a core called the eye of extreme low pressure, and there will be less wind speed at that location, but it is surrounded by strong wind having some sort of a circular contour, and the wind moves counterclockwise in the northern hemisphere and clockwise in the southern hemisphere about this low pressure. And India has a vast coastal line of something like 7,516 kilometers, both eastern coast and western coast. And out of this, like about 5,770 kilometers, that is affected by the cyclone or the cyclone prone region. But why it happens, that is because of the location of our country. Basically, you can see from this figure that basically the cyclones happens like between, that is 5 to 30 degree from the equator, both like on the northern and southern hemisphere. So that is the reason why like we have like our eastern coast subjected to the cyclone almost like every year. And the NTMA, they have prepared the cyclone frequency map, and you can see there like how many cyclones are there, and also they have classified depending upon the damage which the cyclone has created, and how many cyclones are there exceeding certain value. So all these details are there. Like generally, like you have problem with Chennai, Calcutta, Visakhapatnam, Bhubaneswar, Puri, Pondicherry, then like somewhere in the Agartala. So everywhere in the eastern coast, like you have problem. But I think this time, I think there was one in the western coast as well. So both eastern and western coast, they are prone to cyclones, but the eastern coast is more prone to the cyclone. Coming to the structure of cyclone, basically, as I told you, there is a center or eye, and this eye hole region that has like a heavy cloud, basically along with the cyclone, like there is a rain and also like there is a storm surge. So we may have to consider that as well. And also what is important is, apart from like there is a variation of the wind speed along the elevation, like there is a variation in the circumferential wind speed as well, and the extent can be like up to 300 to 600 kilometer. So these are some of the important aspect one has to consider. And you can see here that depending on the strength of the wind, how rough will be the sea and also the wave height. And you can see the supersonic cyclonic storm, like something like 222 kilometer per hour. There, it could be something like a 14 meter storm surge that could be there. So I think from this, probably we can make a guess that in the Rameshwaram cyclone, the wind speed was something like, say, 80, 85 kilometer per hour, because the storm surge was something like 7 meter. Now, coming to the variation, we talked about the variation with time. So there is a mean wind, and then there are fluctuations or the eddies, and these fluctuating component or the turbulence, that is represented both like in the, you can say in the vertical direction, lateral direction, and the longitudinal direction. And then like you have, like there is a variation with respect to the height. And not only that, like being a structure which is spanning along the space, like at one end and the other end, they may not be the same. So all these aspects with respect to the turbulent wind speed, one has to consider for the design. And just to make you understand, like depending the different effect of terrain and the topography, like I have this particular figure, you can see that the approaching wind, like you have something like 0.8V, but there are certain obstructions which are there before it reaches this particular structure. So because of this obstruction that offers some sort of a resistance to the movement of the wind, there is a reduction in the speed. So what you get here is something like 0.6 VG. And here you can see that VG is the gradient wind speed, but there is an acceleration of wind speed because of the hill. And here at the top, it got speeded up and it is something like 1.2 VG. But the hillock actually, it sheltered the leeward side structure. So what has happened is that the wind coming from this side, because of the sheltering effect, it is felt only as 0.4 VG. So we can say that both the terrain as well as the topography has its own effect, and the speed may increase or decrease depending on where the structure is located. So we have to specify for the design the wind velocity profile. So there are either a power law or log law. Generally, logarithmic law is used to specify that in the design codes. Then there are some decaying factor. As I told you, with respect to the space, there is a variation. So to consider the decaying effect, like you have the coherence values, they can be also used. And ultimately, the important one is what is the energy content of the wind. So you have a power spectra for longitudinal wind fluctuation, for lateral wind fluctuation, and vertical wind fluctuation, which you will have to consider when you really start doing something like a response of the structure to the turbulent wind, or you call it as a buffeting analysis. Now coming back about the size and shape, which are important with respect to the structure, you see here that there is a rectangular shape structure and the wind is impinging, and this is the stagnation point. And from these corners, the flow is getting separated. As the width is low, basically it remains separated. And you can see that the width of the wake is quite large. And because of which, like this is subjected to a large drag force. Actually, like this flow can be measured with the help of pressure measurements. And by integrating that, you can work out what is the drag coefficient. But what will happen, like you have a square box here. Here, basically, again, the flow separates, but it gets reattached. And what happens that the width of the wake is small, but you can see that there are certain vortices generated in the wake also. So, but you will see here that compared to this, this will have less value for the drag coefficient. Then, like, what are the other effect, like you consider, basically for, you can say for the structure, you may see that whether how much it deflects or what is the stress, stress will have to be checked under the wind, or whether the wind has a destabilizing effect on the structure or not, whether there is some sort of a like uplifting or any such thing likely to happen, or the dynamic wind effect, like the limited amplitude oscillation, like vortex induced oscillation or buffeting that is there, or like there is a divergent amplitude oscillation like galloping or flutter that is to be there. But these are mainly related to the long span bridges. But I think why we should talk with respect to short or medium span bridges, that is a question. But we have to see whether they are applicable to us or not, because there is slender sections of bridges are coming up, and also the deck width is getting reduced and the width is increasing. So whether we can still apply the same as what we were doing in the past, that is a question mark. Now coming to the wind induced forces, basically this is a box section. As I told you, when the wind impinges, like the pressure is felt on the surface, but because of the pressure distribution around is not uniform, so you can integrate and you can get the values of like the force in the along wind direction, or like the across wind direction, or the lift direction, FL, that is in the vertical direction. And as the pressure distribution is not uniform, it is also likely to be subjected to a moment. So this FM. So we have basically three coefficients, like CD, CL, and CM. And they change with the angle of incidence of wind. And so these are important to be specified or to be considered for the wind resistance design. Now, briefly talking about the vortex excitation, actually the vortices are shed. And you can see that when the vortices are shed from the top surface and bottom surface, it is subjected to some forces, that is upward force, downward force, upward force, downward force. And that happens basically only at a particular range of wind speed, and that is governed by the Strouhal number. And we say that at that low speed, like what I told you about the bridge in Russia, something like 11 meter per second, it happened. So at that time, there will be some limited amplitude of oscillation, but there the amplitude was too high. Probably the check was not done for that particular bridge. That's why the amplitude of oscillation was too large. But limited amplitude oscillation can also cause discomfort to the user. It can lead to fatigue as well. And it may be a problem for even your short span bridges, maybe 60 meter or 80 meter bridges, maybe the pedestrian bridges, but they may be subjected to this sort of vortex-induced oscillation. Then the buffeting, basically it is defined as the forced random response of bridge deck to fluctuation in wind, which is either produced by the natural turbulence or because of the upwind obstruction. For example, you have two parallel decks. So the wind flow around the second deck will get affected by the presence of the first deck. So that sort of turbulence needs to be considered. Again, it is a limited amplitude oscillation, but for a designer, one has to worry about the fatigue that is likely to happen. Now, the flutter, which is a divergent amplitude oscillation for the wind, and why we should consider for a 200 meter span bridge, that is a question mark, but I will show you some example. Basically, it originates from mutual interaction of elastic inertial force and damping and self-excited aerodynamic force. Basically, it's a fluid structure interaction problem. There are two type of flutter that is likely to happen. One is a damping driven flutter, which is because of the negative aerodynamic damping, which happens in bluff cross section, bluff trapezoidal box section. And the stiffness driven flutter, or a classical flutter, where there is a coupling of mode, that is the vertical and torsional mode coupling, that generally happens in streamlined cross sections. Now, as I told you, the terrain, topography, they are all important. And how do you find the effect? Generally, that is obtained with the help of a full model study, where you have the surroundings also simulated. And but this needs a very large wind tunnel. And you can see at the entrance of the test section, some sort of spires are provided. Basically, these spires and the roughness elements which are found there, they are used to generate the, the wind inside this particular tunnel. So I think some of the standards, they have specified something like 1:2000 scale for the topography representation inside the wind tunnel. But what is important is to get the actual detail of these elements which are there in the surrounding. That itself is a big difficulty many times. Now, coming to a case study of a medium span cable stayed bridge. Basically, we have few of these cable stayed bridges constructed over the railway lane or railway yard. You have one in Krishnarajpuram, one in Nagpur, one in Burdwan. So they are basically asymmetric cable stayed bridges, and length less than 200 meter. And here in this case, the bridge has a length of 188 meter, main span length of 124 meter, which is a steel concrete composite section, and the side span is of a concrete cross section, and it has three cable planes, and harp pattern has been used, and nine cables per plane has been used, and spacing between the cable in the main span is 12 meter, and spacing between the cable in the side span is 6.8 meter, and height of the pylon is not that large, it is 62.32. And you can see the deck width of something 27.7 meter, and the width of the side span is something 28.2 meter. what is important when we talk about the bridge deck cross section is about these crash barrier and the railings what we provide them. They are also very, very important, because the railing, like depending on the solidity ratio, it may allow the wind to pass through, but this thing, something like this, that will attract more wind forces. So the vibration study of this particular bridge was done, and you can see that the first vertical mode was at 0.52 getting excited, and the lateral mode of the pylon was getting excited at 0.71, and the first symmetrical torsional mode of the deck was at 0.72. So you can see that this ratio of these two, that was 1.38 less than 2. So you have to see whether a coupling of coupled flutter is likely to occur, or you have to see that during the design, like it doesn't happen, it is not likely to happen. You have to eliminate the occurrence of flutter during the design itself. So that is very important aspect. So what is important with this is that all these frequency values are quite close to each other. And the question may arise for a designer, how many modes one has to consider. And I would say that at least the modes which are lower than the 2 hertz, one should consider for this sort of study. So this indicates that it is not only the deck, but also the pylon also will have to be checked with respect to the wind forces. Now, there is a provision available in the BD-49, which can be used for a preliminary design. Basically, what we do is we work out a parameter that is the aerodynamic susceptibility parameter, PB, which is a function of rho B square M. Rho is nothing but the mass density of air, B is the width of the deck, L is the span, and VR is the hourly mean wind speed at site, and FV is the natural frequency of the bending mode, and we have to work out that. And for this particular case, it was worked out and found that it is 0.55, which lies between 0.04 to 1. So even this less than 200 meter, this bridge that happened to be aerodynamically susceptible. And this is the wind tunnel which we have in erstwhile SERC Ghaziabad. You can say that this is a Make in India wind tunnel, done it in 90s. And still functioning. It is a closed circuit wind tunnel, and it has two test section. One was one which we used to test like cooling tower, chimney, etc. Like some grouping effect of cooling tower, chimney, etc. has been done. And in this particular test section, which is 1.5 meter wide and 0.5 meter height and 2 meter, where at the entrance of the test section, instead of the spires which I showed you, we have number of unequally spaced rods provided to simulate the boundary layer. And this has been used to do the testing both for the Naini Bridge and this Burdwan Bridge. So you can see here the deck, and you can see the longitudinal girders, and then the cross girders, and also the railings, as well as the crash barrier. So these are some of the details of the crash barrier and the railing post, which we did incorporate in the model. And this is the model, and this model is in 1:40 scale, and it was weighing something like 14.65 kg. And one important aspect is that we have to see with respect to the size of the test section, what is the size of the model, and the blockage should not be more than 5 to 6%, because otherwise what we are getting may not be that correct. So basically this represents something like 57.6 meter of the prototype, and this is the strain gauge balance which is there on both sides of the both ends of the sectional model, and these three component force balance was used for the measurement. You can see here some of the views. That is, we change the wind angle also. So you can see that these are all the cross beams and these are the longitudinal beams, and you can see the railings what we provided, number of them provided. And ultimately, what we get is a different wind angle, what is the drag coefficient, what is the lift coefficient, and what is the moment coefficient. And here I have put this dCd by d alpha, that is the derivative of the drag coefficient with respect to the wind angle, with derivative of the lift coefficient with respect to wind angle, derivative of moment coefficient with respect to the wind angle. They are also useful and required when you want to do the buffeting analysis for this type of bridge deck. So there you need, and also to check whether the galloping is not happening. Also, like, you need this DCL by D alpha and CD values. So all these things are important with respect to the wind resistant design. Now, coming quickly to the wind features of the IRC6, what is existing in IRC6, basically the wind map as in IS 875 part 3, that is originally, which was there in IS 875 part 3 1987, was incorporated, and subsequently it was amended with IS 875 part 3 in 2015. And we use this hourly mean wind speed and the pressure, and they have been presented in a tabular form. And these values basically corresponds to a basic wind speed of 33 meter per second. And we say how that can be used for the other locations also. And here, rather than what IS 875 specified, that instead of the four terrain category, we have two terrain category for the bridges. One is the plain and the urban situation. That is, the terrain category 1 and 2 has been combined, and we give the value corresponding to the terrain category 1 for the plain, and terrain category 3 and 4 were combined and gave the value corresponding to TC3 for the urban situation. And the table gives the value for the flat topography considering a return period of 100 years. That is, the K1 is already incorporated. And then, like, we have for the construction stage, like, we use 70% of the wind pressure to be taken, and for funneling effect, like, the wind pressure to be increased by 20%, also for to consider some acceleration due to topographical effect, like, we increase the wind pressure by 20%. And when we are using this hourly mean wind speed, we have to have a gust factor. So gust factor has been introduced, and a uniform value of 2 has been used for spans up to 150 meter. Basically, its applicability is a span length of 150 meter, and where the height of the pier is up to 100 meter. The wind load computed on horizontal, that is transverse, longitudinal, and vertical direction of the superstructure. So drag and lift coefficients for the superstructure for different conventional bridge types are given, like, for example, slab bridge or a box girder bridge, or it is a truss bridge, like how to take the drag coefficients, that is given. Also, for different shapes of the substructure, the drag coefficient is given. So if you see how we have come up, this is the first figure shows the wind map in 1966 in IRC6. Then subsequently, we introduced this IS 875 part 3 1987 into our IRC6 2010. And these are the, we are giving only up to 100 meter. And for the plain terrain and the urban situations, the pressure values are given so that the designer can quickly select the value corresponding to the height of the deck. For the other winds zones, like, it will have to be appropriately computed. Now, like, we calculate the transverse wind force by PZ into G into CD into A1, where A1 is the frontal area. And for the lift force, like, we use the lift coefficient, which is taken as plus minus 0.75, and A2, and the A2 is the plan area. So the first one, the drag coefficient, it is the drag force, it is the frontal area, and the longitudinal force is generally taken as 0.25 times that of the transverse wind load. So that is how like we compute these things. And I have given here a table, and you can see that depending upon the wind speed variation, how the values are getting changed. And you can see that when the B by D ratio is increasing, the wind force what is affecting, that is also getting reduced. So this sort of calculation has been done for both plain as well as like your urban situations, because it was felt at that time by the BSS committee that we have either bridges over some rivers, or maybe there in some urban flyovers, etc., will be there. So that was the main reason why at the time we thought of making, instead of the 4 terrain categories, make it to 2 terrain categories. And for the truss elements, like either it may be a built-up section, or it may consist of some round members, but when the round members are there, the drag coefficient depends on also on the Reynolds number effect. So that is why we have this DVZ calculation to be done. And if it is less than 6 m² per second, then these are the values, that is 1.2, 1.2, etc., depend on the solidity ratio. If it is more than that, then it will be a lower value. But depending upon, because there will be a right upstream side truss and a leeward side truss. So depending upon the truss space ratio, like there can be some shielding factor can also be applied to the drag coefficient. So that provision is also there. And for the pier, depending upon what is the T by B ratio for different shapes, like what can be the like your drag coefficients to be considered for the design. So these are some of the things which we have introduced in the IRC6. Now, as I told you, like we are making some change. So before making some change, I was just thinking, like where we do stand in compared to the normal quotes which are there, like for other countries. So just for curiosity, I was reading some literature. Then I found one paper published in ASCE Bridge Engineering Journal in 2012, where they have studied what happens like for the tall piers of the bridges. How to do the wind calculation, etc. So here they have considered this Chinese general code for bridges, and these are not for long span bridges. So that's why like I have considered them. If you see here how they calculate the transverse wind load, again, like there is a K0, K1, K3, WD and AWH. AWH is nothing but that frontal area sort of thing, and WD is nothing but the wind pressure. But the design wind speed, they consider K2 into K5, and what exactly is K2 is the modification for the wind speed along the height. Basically, it consider different terrains, and in China, they have considered A, B, C, D. 4 terrain categories, and K5 is basically like their gust factor, gustiness in the wind. And here, like what they are considering is basically an average, averaging time of 10 minutes is what they are considering for their wind speed, and a return period of 100 year is considered. So what they do is this K0 value, what you have, that value K0, K1, they are applying basically like to the wind pressure. So K0 is just like your K1 factor in IS 875. But here this K0 is taken as 1 for like long span or super long span and other span bridges, you take it as 0.9. And for construction, they are considering 0.75. We are considering 70% pressure. So that is how they have done this particular calculation. And this is a Japanese manual. What they have doing is, again, half rho, VD square, CH, GV, and AS. Again, they have also considered like 10-minute averaging speed for the wind. And they have taken a gust factor of 1.9. And you can see that the VD equal to E1 into V10. V10 is the basic wind speed at 10 meter height. And E1 is again related to the height and terrain roughness. So these some of these standards, they have something similar to what we do, like British standards. Again, like you can see that 0.613 VD square, we have also 0.6, half rho V square, 0.6. So there is some small variation in the density value what we use, VD square A1 into D. And VD, they have they are obtaining by multiplying the VS with a SG. SG is some sort of a gust factor. But in the case of British standard, they have different 3-4 parameters they consider to work out the gust factor. In ASHTO, they do it in a different way. They have basically three terrain categories. One is an open country, and another is a suburban area, and another is for cities. And again, they have a formula, but they take that at 10 meter, they consider 160 kilometer per hour as the wind speed. And then they do the calculation depending upon the friction velocity for different terrains. So that is how they do it. So to put these things in a nutshell, I found that like this applicability was up to ours is 150 meter and 100 meter tall pier, Japanese also 200 meter, British also 200 meter span and 200 meter height. Everywhere the wind speed what we specify is at least these 3-4 codes, it is at the local wind speed what we have to consider, that there is a map and from there we have to select what should be the speed. And ASHTO, they specify 100 kilometer per hour. Averaging time, I think ours like 1 hour, and British and ASHTO also 1 hour, the other two they are doing a 10 minute. And return period, I think 100 year or 120 year. And 70% wind pressure for construction. China, they use 0.75 for the construction. And we have two terrain category right now. And China has 4. And Japanese, they have 5 category. And British also, they have, I think, 5 category. I forgot to write it here. And ASHTO, they have 3 categories there. And for funneling, like we consider 1.2, that is we are increasing the wind pressure by 20%. Here the value is something between 1.2 to 1.4 for gorges and mountain passes. And they have given one value for the valleys, which we have not given. It is something like 0.75 to 0.85. And gust factor, we are giving 2. And our gust factor, we are multiplying with the wind pressure. And Japanese, they have given 1.9. And here you will see that they are multiplying in China either by the wind speed itself by 1.38. That is, the square of that will actually come into picture. So this is an international comparison. And now how to, we are proposing, there is a IRC loads and stresses committee. And there, like there is a subcommittee which is working on this particular revision. So consider the bridge deck level, span of bridge, cross section, location of bridge, terrain topography, identify the wind speed zone. As I told you earlier that we have to follow the NDMA guidelines. So we will be using what is given in IS 875 part 3 2015, which is amended in June 2020 with the NBC wind map. So that will be used. Then we may go that for small bridges up to 40 meter span, rather than like using the mean hourly wind speed and all, maybe we use the peak gust method for wind speed, considering the terrain and topography and cyclonic susceptibility. There is a factor given in IS 875, that is a K4 factor, which is 1.15 and 1.3, depending upon like where it is situated within that 60 kilometer zone. So there, like we work out that, then compute wind pressure. Then if the span is between 40 meter and 200 meter, and earlier we thought of providing this frequency greater than 2 hertz, but now the question is, if we specify like that, we have to give a formula for working out the this thing. So probably we are just thinking whether we can introduce, instead of the 2 hertz, like bridge width span to width ratio or width to depth ratio more than 30 meter, or like pier height to transverse width ratio exceeding 10, then we have to consider the aerodynamic effect. So here, like we have an option to, if the span is between 40 and 200 meter and not susceptible to aerodynamic action, then we use the both peak gust and hourly mean wind speed and take maximum of the two. And then like we work out the aerodynamic susceptibility parameter and check it, and then decide whether the wind tunnel testing is required. After deciding which are the wind-induced oscillations to which the bridge deck may be susceptible. Otherwise, don't use any wind tunnel testing. So now coming to the proposed change, this IS 875 Part 3, this was recently amended with the NPC wind map. And you can see that there are certain changes in the map shapes, like I think the green or the yellow or the blue, whatever is there, there is some change here. So what exactly is the change? I was trying to understand. Then I was really surprised, because the Delhi, Chandigarh, etc., we were just considering, oh, it is 47 meter per second. That is the basic wind speed that is going to enhance to 50 meter per second. And Roorkee, which was earlier 39, that is jumping to 50 meter per second. But Almora, Pokhara, they were 47. They are coming down to 39. And Darbhanga, I was surprised to see from 55 to 47. But I don't understand, like, what is the rationale behind the, this change. Probably I have to understand with some, discuss with some of the wind expert and understand why this sort of change has happened. I am not sure about it. And then I got another interesting study from of Professor Arnab Sarkar of IIT BHU. Actually, what I told you earlier, that the wind climate in India is something different from that is there abroad. And also, like, you have to do a statistical analysis. So you have like some different extreme value analysis can be performed. And if it is a pressure wind sort of thing, generally, like your type 1 distribution, FT type 1 distribution, that is applicable. But here, what is happening is that, like they have tried to do a Weibull distribution for this for a different location, and try to find out how the values are there in IS 875, which was done long back, and you can see that not much variation is there, which is something good. But what I understand here, that the whoever is doing the analysis, they are also telling that not a particular distribution will be suitable for all wind characteristics of our country. Probably we have to see Gumbel or reverse Weibull and other distribution also, and maybe some of them will have some different distribution. So that means some sort of a research is still going on. Probably, I think they can refer to the earlier study of Professor Sitaramlu. That will also be of very helpful. Now, another thing then, out of curiosity, I just tried about the roughness factors which are given in the Eurocode. Again, Eurocode has five different terrain categories, but because of the NDMA guidelines, we will be sticking to what is given in IS 875 part 3. But with respect to the assessment of terrain roughness, we would like to make a change because our structures are spanning. And what happens is that suppose like we have something like a structure over a road, and then like there are on both sides some small buildings are there, then the question will arise like what should be the terrain category. So probably when there is a choice between these two, two or more terrain category, one may be something like a plain and another may be towards the urban situation. So the lower one, roughness should be used as per this Eurocode provision. So that we will be trying to incorporate, then the checking the susceptibility of aerodynamic oscillation, which I explained you with an example. Then one important question is like, what should be the damping for the various structural components, which we have not addressed so far because we have steel bridge with lattice tower. This is again from the Eurocode, then composite bridge, then concrete bridge, either PSC or a RCC crack section. But I found that some of them are little on the conservative side, but I am interesting to see they have included for the cables, which may be useful for the cable stayed bridges, because we are making a guideline for the cable stayed bridges in B9 committee, where there is a chapter on the wind characteristics, which we are drafting with the help of Professor, under the guidance of Professor Prem Krishna. So probably some of them will be useful there as well. So definitely without damping, because as I told you, I showed you an example where like there was a vortex excitation in a probably a conventional sort of bridge, and it, these dampers have been used. So I think when we are moving towards the high strength material and when we are reducing the deck thickness, but be careful about what will happen with the wind induced oscillation also. So the damping also plays a vital role, and structural damping one has to consider for the design. So this is what I have thought of, like starting from the wind climate and what about the averaging time, and also how the wind characteristics are to be considered or incorporated in the design. I have explained with an example of the wind tunnel testing, as well as what is there in IRC and what is likely to be changed. And suggestions are most welcome. Thank you very much for the patience hearing, and it will be, I'll be happy to answer some of the questions. I'm sure maybe I may not be able to answer some of them, but I'm sure that there are certain learned people here who will help me in answering such questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lakshmi. Wonderful presentation. You have thoroughly covered the subject right from the basic wind characteristics and brought the entire wind effects scenario on the bridges. There are questions. There are, as you rightly said, there are learned audience who have been listening and watching all this. There are some questions. I'll just pick up out of that lot. First one was from an attendee, why mass dampers are used in that particular bridge, which you showed in the beginning, why mass dampers are used? Briefly, you can, maybe some young engineer.
Actually, I think that is one way, like you can reduce the amplitude of oscillation, and there the amplitude of oscillation was too high, like something like 400 mm. And with the damper installed, they could succeed in reducing the amplitude to something like 40 mm. So that was the reason why they installed it. And I think they have done some internal studies, etc. But I think probably some literature is available. I think they can look into that for more details. I am also like not fully aware because such details are not given. What was the reason why selected that type of particular damper? But what I am happy to say that they could rectify the problem quite quickly because of the right design. And I think because the dampers are available, and I think some German professors and all, they were involved in the project, and they helped Maurer in doing the right damper design.
Next is a not a very technical question, but can say the legal thing that IS 875 Part 3 1987 has been revised in the year 2015. As IS 875 Part 3 2015 is still, most of us are preferring old one. I would like to address it directly that it is not like we are preferring. It is only the ignorance of the people who are using the old one. As you have rightly said that it has further been, amendment has been issued in June 2020, incorporating all the up-to-date corrections, including the new wind map, which was there in NBC 2016. So a rational user will always refer the website of the BIS and use the updated code only. Using any old version is not correct. So I think that is the answer to this. And Dr. Suresh was there. I hope he's still there, he's attending. He's raised some very good climate questions. First one from him is, USA and Australia, similar climate like us, even in cyclone peak to mean, is very different from that of pressure system wind, Durst curve. There is a lot of papers on this by Wickett and Miller. So I can't agree that wind in India is different from US and Australia, maybe slightly different from Europe and Canada. You may choose to answer this or you may...
I think I understand that probably there is a committee which is looking into it at BIS level. So, and I think what I found one important aspect is that how the cyclonic effect is addressed by different code is different. For example, the British, what they have used is, they have not used a K4 factor, but probably they are incorporating something in the load factor, okay, for a cyclonic region to take into account that. So there they have used again a factor of 1.25 there. So I think more or less people are addressing it, but how they are addressing also we have to see, and probably not much change will be there, but some additional factors they are considering to enhance the wind speed. And so I do
the matter of the committee on the wind characteristics and extreme wind studies and all those things.
Yes.
Suresh has already been doing some analysis and presenting in another webinar also, I have heard him. So maybe we see some changes in the coming time. That's the thing. There is one question by an listener. Any study conducted on the effect of amphon on second Hooghly Bridge and Howrah Bridge? Where are these studies published? If you have any information, please.
I don't have any information. Probably somebody can do it. Probably they can recheck the design for the speed which happened. Probably that will be a good exercise. Even for the Howrah Bridge I showed, it will be a good exercise to see the old sections, how what sort of stresses were felt at that time and the joints and what happened to that. Maybe a interesting study can be done.
I remember. I'm sure that Professor Prem Krishna is also listening. And I remember that second Hooghly Bridge, Vidyasagar Setu, was studied in IIT Roorkee wind tunnel long back. So maybe sir can throw some light if some information is there with him or somebody is intending to take up any study. Good afternoon, sir.
Hello, good afternoon. The second Hooghly Bridge, we did do some model tests in at Roorkee, but those were not for wind. These are models which were prepared to, firstly, to determine the seismic response. And the second one was built, constructed to study the loading pattern and the response pattern and so on. So we didn't do a wind tunnel study at Roorkee. But a wind tunnel study on the second Hooghly was done in IISc, Bangalore.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Mr. S. Khurana is asking, Madam, the railway bridges have higher speeds, higher axle loads, as well as higher frequency of repetitive loadings. What would be the differences in wind loading parameters in road and railway bridges in coastal areas?
Road and railway bridges in coastal areas. I think in coastal areas, as I told you, like along with the wind, you will have to consider the storm surge also, which is likely to be there. And probably with respect to the road bridges, like again, this storm surge, what will happen, some sort of a wave, etc., action will be there on the deck. So in IRC, right now, we don't have a provision for wave forces on the wind, on the bridges. But now we are preparing it with the help of NIOT. So maybe next year that will be there. Probably the same thing can be extended if something is there for the applicability can be checked. I'm not very sure about it. And otherwise for the coastal region, like whatever is given in IS 875 part 3, like such sort of application can be done. And if cyclonic prone area is there, then this K3 factor, etc., can be included.
Okay.
And probably one can do is that some sort of a anchorage can be provided for the deck with the substructure, so that like it doesn't slide. Something what you do for the submerged bridge, like some sort of a anchoring is done. So that sort of thing can be done so that the movement in the lateral direction or in the longitudinal direction of the deck also can be prevented.
I can see Alok Bhaumik also connected here. So Alok can throw some light on this particular anchorage issue. The bridges in the coastal area.
Yeah, on the coastal area where, you know, you have the cyclonic effects. Actually, you know, I think today we are discussing on the short and medium span bridges. And I believe that, you know, these impacts on the short and medium span bridges is perhaps not as much. And perhaps the earthquake considerations, you know, starts dictating as far as the detailing of the structure is concerned. On the wind forces, I mean, the uplift wind or the lateral wind vis-a-vis the dead load of the structures, particularly for short and medium span bridges, I don't really think that this is an issue which is a matter of great concern.
Okay. Maybe some studies can reveal those kind of things when more data is available. Thank you. Dr. S.K. Sharma from Indore, who's currently in the teaching profession, but earlier he was in CPWD. I know him personally. He's asking a very relevant question. What can be the order of error in determination of various parameters based on wind tunnel testing of bridges? Primarily, I think Dr. Sharma wants to ask, how do the wind tunnel testing compares with the theoretical calculations?
Actually, the parameters what we find probably from the wind tunnel studies, these are actually the drag coefficient, lift coefficient, etc. So the how faithfully you are modeling the geometric shape of the model, that plays a vital role. And also how good you are able to simulate the wind characteristics inside the tunnel. Those things are very, very important aspect. And why we are going for wind tunnel study is that, like, for example, you have an open web section, like you are not able to do obtain the parameters related to that with the help of a CFD study, but maybe some sort of a closed structure like a box section, probably one can think of doing it using CFD also. But the railings, etc., which are provided, that you will not be able to do a proper work with the help of CFD. So that is the reason why you are going for the wind tunnel studies. But the error, what it can be, I think difficult to say. Probably the what can happen is that one has to really see how they have done the normalization. And generally, like the wind engineers have their own language. For example, whatever they do with respect to the cross-section, the directions, etc. So one has to be clear about the parameters, what they have used in normalizing these CD, CL, CM coefficients. Because some people use frontal area, some people use the B. So like that, the coefficients may, the order of the coefficient may change. So one has to be really careful about how they have prepared the report and how they have done it. I think one has to pay attention to that.
Dr. Lakshmi?
Yes.
CFD is one other way in which perhaps one can try to get results for aerodynamic effect. And it may not exactly agree with what you do in the wind tunnel. There will be differences, but at least it can probably confirm whether your results are in the right, right order.
So preliminary studies in CFD would help refinement of the wind tunnel studies, which may be more time consuming in otherwise also. Like that. I'll take a question from Saurav Hajra. I believe he's a young bridge designer. Is that wind tunnel model flexible or rigid? And what is the material of the model?
Actually, what I showed was a sectional model. Sectional model, basically, it represents only a part of the deck. And for this particular study, just for the measurement, what we have done, it is the material what we have used is basically perspex there. And I remember, I think we have some aluminium sections on which this perspex was used, pasted to get the make the deck. But if you are really going for something like your studies, that is on the dynamic model study, again, the sectional model, then probably your stiffness, etc., will have to be represented using some spring. That is, the sectional model will have to be hung with some sort of a spring get the related values with respect to the wind-induced oscillation.
Okay, probably this also answers the question from Dr. Suresh, how the frequency and damping simulated in the sectional model test. So it is basically using the spring support. At the end,
yeah.
The section. Okay, thank you. Saurav again asked one more question. Here the closed circuit wind tunnel have been used for testing. What is the difference in data if we use open circuit wind tunnel?
I don't think,
basically, the tunnel
all depend on tunnel. Like the tunnel characteristics will have to be seen. How good is your, what speed you can achieve, and how
well you can model the
model the surface. Yeah.
Probably there is a heat generated in the post circuit wind tunnel.
You are not audible, sir.
Yeah, heat generated, I think, in some closed circuit wind tunnel. Probably that is what he is talking about.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Can I, hello. Abhay, Dr. Abhay, can I ask a question? This is Dr. Harshvardhan.
Sir, yes, you can.
Thank you, Dr. Lakshmi. Very, very clear presentation, an extremely clear and cogent presentation. Thank you very much. Just a few points and questions. One is, when do we use CFD and when do we use a wind tunnel, or do we use them both together? Professor Prem Krishna did reply that partly. When do we use only a cross-sectional study, and when do we do a full-blown, full bridge, full cable-stay bridge, or full bridge modeled with the terrain, etc., complete study? Or is it sufficient just to do a cross-section study?
And Dr. Harshvardhan has asked a full book. Now, how much?
And the last point I'm asking is that flowchart that you showed, if we can go back to it and discuss that, if you can just discuss that again, I missed part of it. So there's a flowchart you used, you showed.
Yes. bridge studies.
Yeah, that bridge, yeah. So could we just discuss these?
Yeah.
Yeah, this one.
What you want, I have to explain this again?
Yes, if you can, madam.
Okay. Basically, what we are thinking of deciding how to modify the existing clause, like consider the bridge deck level, span of the bridge cross section, and span of the bridge and the cross section, location, terrain, topography. After considering that, then identify where the bridge is located. And for the wind speed map, we will be using the IS 75 Part 3 2015, which is amended in June 2020. So that will be used. And what we are proposing is that there will be two methods. One is using the peak guess method, where the averaging time of the wind is just 3 seconds. That only will be considered for if the span of the bridge is less than 40 meter.
Right.
And what is given in IS 875 Part 3, we will be having K1, K2, K3, and K4 factor. And if the location is susceptible to cyclone, then that K4 factor of 1.3 will be considered. Otherwise, like it will be only one. Then for 40 meter and 200 meter span, like now the question comes like whether is it is dynamic or not, that particular structure is. So there, like first we thought of putting this frequency values, but there instead of putting that frequency, what I am proposing is that is if the bridge with span to width ratio or width to depth ratio greater than 30, or like pier height to transverse width ratio exceeding 10. This instead of the frequency values, that is a right. Proposal. I think you can give your suggestion.
Very good. So idea.
If it is less than these values, then we are again doing computing the wind pressure and like you are using both peak guess method and like you are hourly mean wind speed and taking the maximum value of that. And here we are doing for all the three direction, that is in the transverse direction, longitudinal direction, and the vertical direction. And then, but if it is susceptible, then like we are working out, that is the aerodynamic susceptibility parameter. And then if it is something between 0.04 and 1, then decide, okay, to which oscillation it is susceptible to. Then accordingly, you prescribe, okay, these are the wind tunnel tests to be done.
Right. And about the CFD and wind tunnel, of course, you'd use them combined. But is it just sufficient to do a cross-sectional study in most cases?
Cross-sectional study is generally preferred because it is easy. So if you have a bridge where like you don't have much effect of this terrain and topography, then it will be better for you to go for a sectional model study.
Right.
And only thing, when you do a sectional model study, one has to be one has to think about that there is not much blockage is there and the wind and the structure has been properly simulated.
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Mr. Kishore Patil has asked, up to what span length, medium and long span differentiated?
That is what I showed you. Many of the codes, they are specifying up to 200 meter. And beyond that, I think they say, again, like I think there can be some other divisions also, some 500 meter or 1000 meter. And beyond that, super span, super long span and all such things. So it is all like how much you can define it and whatever is the span length you select and properly define it. Because right now, like in IRC, we have only like a major bridge, minor bridge, that sort of classification, and a major bridge up to 60 meter.
Okay.
Above 60 meter.
Madam, just one more point to add.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll ask that at the end. You go ahead. Abhay, you were saying something. You go ahead. I'll ask my question.
Yeah, there are two questions which are related. One by Mr. S.D. Kiran. What about gust factor value for the second truss bridge when two steel truss bridges are kept aside? And Rajiv Ahuja is asking how to take shielding factor for two closely spaced concrete bridges. IRC 6 does not cover it.
I think Mr. Rajiv Ahuja is asking, it is probably not shielding. Probably what should be the space between the two decks? I think proximity effect, that sort of thing I understand. I think we will be introducing appropriately, because I think what should be the distance between the two decks, that is important, because the vortices shed from the first one that can change the wind on the upwind side of the second deck. So how close these two decks can be, I think that criteria will also be given in the clause.
Something similar is there in the building code, where there are shielding effect on the frames which are occurring one behind the other. Maybe
yes, some kind of the shielding effect is already given here also in okay. In this particular I showed you a table where for the trusses, depending upon the spacing between the truss and the height of the truss, how to calculate the shielding factor, that is already included. But what I understand is something different. Probably you have two parallel decks, and what should be the distance between the parallel decks? I think if it is not that, I think then probably it has to be seen again. Yeah.
So, means to act them as independent bridges for the full wind force or the gust, what should be the distance, what should be the gap between the two?
Yeah, it is the gap basically. The gap. So the proximity effect, or you can say your interference sort of thing. So yeah. What should be the distance between the two?
Okay. Abhay, can I ask a question, Abhay?
Yes, sir. Yes.
This is Dr. Harshvardhan again, madam.
Yes.
The point is, now we've done the study, can you dwell a little about the avoidance? What can we do to avoid the effects of wind on the types of elements of the structure, or the cross-section, on the cables? The impact that wind, adverse impacts, are there any mitigating measures that you might tell us about?
Actually, the part what you are talking about, that is not coming in IRC 6 as such, but it is being included in the chapter corresponding to wind resistant design of that guideline which we are preparing for the cable state bridges. Okay. So there, like what we are doing is, how to minimize the effect of this vortex excitation of the bridge deck, or like for your flutter, buffeting, etc. So in general, I can say that, I think some sort of a aerodynamic modifications, that is geometric modification, that helps in changing some of these phenomena. And another is if suppose there is a flutter likely to happen, if you can increase the ratio of your vertical to torsional frequency, then also you can enhance the flutter speed. And but the main important aspect is the geometric modification. Then again, I think the type of the deck, I think separated decks, or I think provision of grating in the deck. There are so many other things which can be done to enhance the aerodynamic stability. So those things we will be discussing in the cable state bridge document.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ashish Sarode is asking, drag coefficients for pier is valid only when there is no superstructure. Many designers misinterpret and consider these coefficients in design, even in service stage.
What is that? I couldn't get it.
Drag coefficient for piers.
Pier.
Pier, yeah. Piers is valid only when there is no superstructure. Designers misinterpret and consider these coefficients in design, even in service stage. shall be clearly mentioned in quotes instead of footnote. This is mentioned in footnote, as he is saying, and it should be clearly mentioned.
Okay.
I think if it is mentioned, it's a matter to be referred to the code committee.
Can I add something to what Dr.
Yes,
Harshvardhan?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Dr. Harshvardhan asked a very, very nice question. What do you do about mitigating the effects of wind? As you very well answered, Dr. Lakshmi, it is the geometry which plays a big role here. If you have an aerodynamically designed section, then you do cut down on the loads and the possibility also of oscillations being too large. I think the bottom line is keep flutter out at whatever cost by providing the stiffnesses that are required and shaping the deck, keep flutter out at all costs. I think that is the bottom line. And the other thing I'll say is if you go for super long spans, then people are trying various things like adding fairings to the edges and using pendulums and moving wings and all kinds of things are under research. So that is, I think, for super long spans. I hope I've been able to add something to what Dr. Lakshmi said.
So another thing is the dampers, sir, use of dampers.
Use of dampers, yes.
Yeah, that is also there.
Especially for the cables themselves.
Cables are provided nowadays with the dampers. They are all coming with the dampers. And also, I think some of these cables also, they tie together, etc. So
yes,
that
different ways of cutting the
Different ways. I think it all depends on the site-specific solutions are provided and also depending on the vibration characteristic of the structure.
Yes. Yeah. Ram Prasad Chandrasekharan is asking, is there any software for the wind load calculation? He is into some kind of research. Looking for software for wind load calculation.
I think this RM 2000, I don't know, 6 was earlier. I don't know what is the year now, but probably that has some module for the estimating the buffeting effect, etc. For the cable state structure and all. But the thing is, like, you need all these CD, CL, CM, and the derivative, etc., as the input for that. So without that, it will not be of no use. And otherwise, what one can do is, like, you can, instead of doing a full model study, what you can do is, if you have these coefficients available, you can go for a time domain analysis where you can simulate the wind on the full structure and then do a time domain analysis. Of course, there again, depending on the span, you may have to consider the geometric non-linearity of the bridge, and also maybe for the cable, the stiffness has to be, E value has to be properly accounted for. So such things are there, but I think that also the time domain analysis also provides a very good solution for a cable state bridge, because there you are able to get what is the bending moment and shear force at various location when it is subjected to the wind. Only thing, you have to simulate the wind properly, that is considering the spectra and turbulence, intensity, scale, coherence factor, etc. But that will be a good exercise for a designer.
Okay. Thank you. One can always connect with you on the mail also.
May I have a question, Dr. Gupta?
Yes, Alok, please.
Yeah, I have a question to Dr. Lakshmi. First of all, an excellent presentation by her, you know, covering an area, wind engineering, something I think most of us structural engineers are not much aware. I mean, we know more about earthquake, but we know very little about wind. My question is that for short and medium span bridges, for which today's webinar is, how sensitive are the parameters, you know, like what we mentioned about the geometry and about flutter, buffeting, all these things, all these terminology, as my understanding is, they are very, very relevant when the span becomes longer or the structure becomes taller. But if we are talking about bridges in the range of, say, maximum 100 meter span, and if we are talking about bridges which are not cable state bridges, not suspension bridges, not extra dose bridges, how sensitive are these parameters?
Actually, I have something to say on this. My worry is that because I think the vibration characteristic, I am talking about the fundamental mode of the deck in some of the bridges, like what we are measuring, they are all like in the range of 3 to 4 hertz, like something like 40 to 50 meter span bridges. I think in the case of steel concrete composite, maybe that is something like 3.5 to 4, like that also. My worry is that suppose your frequency of vibration is more than 5 hertz, then you don't have too much worry about the vortex-induced oscillation. But if it is lower than that, then probably like they are likely to be affected by the vortex-induced oscillation. And these type of oscillation can happen at a lower wind speed. Okay. So what will happen is that some sort of a vibration will be there. So during the design, one will have to see whether they are within the permissible limit or not. Otherwise, like they are likely to have create fatigue. And ultimately, the life of the structure is going to get affected. So I think in our committee, I think we are trying to consider that aspect also, that what is the frequency of vibration for these small bridges. And I think we have got some input from Mr. Harpreet Singh also. So I think that aspect will be definitely covered. And then that is why like this aerodynamic susceptibility checking that is likely to get into the code, because in some cases it may be required. And you may think that for the extra dose bridge, it may not be required, but I have some sort of a feeling that maybe some sort of a single degree of freedom flutter may happen if the span length is more. Because the values what I got from Mr. Harpreet for the extra dose bridge, they are very low frequency values. So they have to be really seen and then carefully put in the codal practice. But we can't simply say that, okay, now they are safe, because now we are not considering. So we feel that they are not safe. They need not be considered, but that may not be the case. That is why I give you the example of that bridge in Russia.
Just picking up that same point, madam.
Yes.
That same point, this is Dr. Harshvardhan again.
Yeah.
There's a large trend towards the spine beam strut model with cantilevers going up to 11, 12 meters on each side.
Yes, yes.
Tight, you know, a central box of which the wings are done. I'm talking about the spine beam strut typically, and they are typically 40 meters type spans, 32 to 40 meter type spans. Would they be extra susceptible because of the transverse cantilevers and the vibration proneness and the 5 hertz limit that you talked about?
Yeah, that's why, like, if you can provide me with some frequency values and mode shapes of such decks, then it will be good. Then it can be studied and seen whether they are susceptible or not. That will be required.
Right.
Because what I have is some limited measurements of some of these bridges, but may not be even for that bridges we have the drawings. So it becomes sometimes difficult.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Govind Parchani from Indore is asking, during construction, one span constructed and adjacent to be constructed, how wind effect is considered?
One span
is constructed and other is to be constructed on a multi-span bridge. So how the wind effect is to be considered? I think whatever is constructed from there, during construction, it has to be taken. Madam?
I am not very sure about this answer. Maybe I think Mr. Alok or Dr. Harshvardhan can answer this question.
As far as superstructure is concerned, whatever is constructed will
attract wind.
Construction stage analysis. For the construction stage also, yes, you have to do a wind analysis. So that's why, like, we have specified this 70%, because you consider the construction number of years for the construction, maybe less than 5 years, and you consider, but you consider the wind load during the construction also. And also for the, I think the, you can say the temporary structures, they also has to be checked for the wind susceptibility. So at least the forces which are likely to be there. So they have to be designed for that. So such precautions will have to be taken.
Correct. Yeah. In fact, if you want to add to that, in fact, one of the main susceptibilities during construction stage is that when a structure is at maximum cantilever, sort of in a cantilever situation, if you say from one pier, then it is most sensitive to wind. And in some cases worldwide, especially in longer spans, they have used tune mass dampers temporarily at the end of these cantilevers to dampen the wind-induced
But probably this will not occur in the short and medium span.
Not in short and medium, in long spans it could.
So we'll discuss it.
May I add something here?
Yes, Alok.
Yeah, so I think this is a very, very good point which was raised. And I can tell you, I am recently investigating at least 3 failures of bridges during construction. Oh. And during this investigation, what I find is in all the 3 cases, what I found is that during construction stage, the consultant has not taken properly the check for wind. And when I check the wind case during construction, invariably it is critical, invariably. And this is a trend, you know, which I think we need to reverse.
These are cable stays or extra dosses or what?
No, I'm talking about short and medium span bridges only.
Normal
precast.
Normal girder bridges.
Exactly the point I was making.
So you have this precast segmental construction with overhead launchers.
Correct.
And when you are launching, it is highly sensitive to wind, and nobody really, you know, takes it religiously.
That is important. And also the increased susceptibility because of the spine beam strut construction.
Yeah.
That, I mean, such long cantilevers on each side, that, you know, that also may be even more prone to wind. So that's another point I wanted to make, which has been covered. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I think Rajiv Ahuja wants to know, what are the parameters obtained from wind tunnel tests and how they are used in design? You may answer to your choice how long you want to go.
Yeah, actually, it all depends what the designers are looking for. That is what I said. We have to first identify to what type of oscillations they are likely to be susceptible. Then the minimum requirement will be the CD, CL, CM and the derivatives of that, and the values at different wind angles, like plus minus 5 degrees, some people say plus minus 10 degree. And then, like, you have Strouhal number to check the susceptibility, whether it is subjected to vortex excitation. You can go for flutter derivatives to see whether flutter is going to happen or not. So there is maybe the full bridge itself you can see, and the response you can get from that. So many things one can do, but it all depends on what is the design requirement ultimately.
Thank you very much. Is it possible to model pylon also? I have seen some wind tunnel tests where only super.
Yeah, pylon can be modeled. There is no problem. Pylon can be modeled.
Okay.
It can be modeled. And in fact, the pylon, the free standing pylons, because the pylons are also quite tall. So they are also modeled, and then the values are taken. And in fact, for the Akashi Kaiko Bridge and all, they have done some corner cut in the model. So that studies the geometric modification also, they verify by doing the wind tunnel test.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Mukesh, can I add a comment?
Yes, sir.
You know, about this, as Dr. Lakshmi mentioned, in the guidelines that are being prepared, there is a very, very concerted effort that we should give some sort of
NPL app abhi download kijiye aur khelie 40 se bhi zyada exciting games
aur ye kuch beech mein aa gaya. What I was saying is that effort is being made to give some guidelines as to how to decide how much of investigation is going to be required into a bridge aerodynamic problem. However, whatever we do, these will be for conventional systems. You know, you can cover conventional systems, but if you are going to have unusual situations like long cantilevers or some people, it was mentioned to me, somebody is providing a roof over the bridge. So if you have those unusual conditions, I think more or less it will be necessary to go to the wind tunnel and test and the model. Howsoever, we may try to cover ourselves with the guidelines.
True. Mukesh Upadhyay wants to know whether it is logical to have only two terrain category, as in metro cities we have multi-story buildings beyond 10 meter height.
Now we are going to have all the four terrain categories included in the amendment. It was done long back. Probably it started in 97 and got approved in 2007. So at that time they decided only to have two terrain categories, but now it will be for all four terrain categories.
Okay, thank you. Yatin Doshi says whether mass dampers for wind and also seismic isolators can be used in a single bridge together.
Seismic isolators are provided to reduce the seismic demand of the particular bridge. But whether the same bridge is having maximum wind effect and maximum seismic effect, that is very difficult to say. But I think I'm not sure about the answer.
Dr. Harshavardhan, if
you... They are separate phenomena because they occur at largely different frequencies. So the phenomena, the handling of these phenomena are done differently, though they may be needing damping, or though they may be needing systems to intervene and bring down essentially the damping or the period. So they can be both used in tandem. The systems are there for both in tandem, and they can be used separately or in isolation, both.
Okay.
This is, in short, one thing cannot satisfy both. You know, they're separate, separate phenomena.
Thank you. Dr. Suresh from RWDI has raised some points. I'll just go through some 3-4 points are there. One, he says that the wind speed in Delhi is observed to be less than 50, which is recently amended. So maybe that point is that needs more discussions on the committee level, and with data is presented in another webinar. So probably that is an information for us. For funneling, we don't have to apply any factor in case we have topography results. That is what Dr. Suresh is saying for funneling.
Okay.
So that's okay. If you have the topography result, then we don't need.
Yes.
Madam, you're saying anything?
No. It's okay.
Gust factor need not be assumed. We have to use this based on tunnel tests.
No, the gust factor for the value of 2, we arrived after doing various spans for which the gust factor was worked out. So that is how this value of 2 was given. But gust factor from the tunnel for, I think, the medium and short span bridge, I think that will be too much.
Yeah. Also, madam, coming back to that funnel effect which Dr. Suresh had raised, see, we have number of cases like the Jammu Udhampur rail link, where you have, say, our bridge 20, very deep valley, piers are about 90 meters tall, and valley shape is quite V, it's not a U type. And will this attract greater aerodynamic effects because of the funneling and the length of the valley and the reach, the wind reach that is happening? How do we account for it? Is this sufficient to account by 0.7?
Such locations, probably some sort of a study will be required, but right. I think whether you are able to get the topography features like for modeling, etc., in the wind tunnel, then only such study can be done. I think probably right. to get such parameters, I think is very difficult also.
Correct. Yeah. Thank you.
We are already crossing 6 p.m. So and there are a few more questions left. I'll just take two more. And, Alok has raised a very interesting point, which we have been discussing. For wind, why we do not have a single unified code covering buildings and bridges? I myself would like to say on this, it's not only building and bridges, Alok. There are several other structures where wind is an important loading. And probably I feel that there should be one basic wind loading code, means load assessment. And there should be separate code for the design of individual structure for wind effects. That is what is my opinion. Now, what
I agree. Abhay, to add to that, I agree. Because one side is the load side, the other is the response side. The response side is structure specific, height-wise, length-wise, geometry, damping, mass, etc. Totally being different, structured like a cooling tower is totally different from a long bridge or a short span bridge. It completely
communication different. Towers would be different, chimneys would be different. Like we have a chimney.
Mitigation code. Measures are different. So I would say think we need to develop a code which deals with wind as a phenomena and its loading influences.
Correct.
And the other is response side structure specific. You know, structure specific response.
What sir says? Prem Krishna sir? Sir, hai? Madam, what do you say?
I think wind load probably, I think it can be given. That's why I think probably we are also extending whatever is given in IS 875 for the bridges. For defining the wind characteristics, etc. But for the design, maybe some cases like you need the pressure coefficients, or sometimes like you need the force coefficients. So it all like depends on how you are doing the design, and then those things can be considered. But what I wanted to tell you is that even the averaging time of the wind, that is also varying within our national code itself. So such things probably, I think we can try to do the unification. For example, I showed you the example of a Chinese code. Actually, China has prepared three different codes. And all the three codes, I think certain parameters are the same.
I agree. Averaging time is a basic wind characteristics, wind assessment parameter. So that should
be
wind assessment. That's correct. But as far as design of
If I may just...
Alok.
So basically what I meant, although I have written bridges, but what I meant is exactly the same what you mentioned. That is, there should be one unified code for wind. And what you are saying that for loading, we can have one code, and then for components, we can have separate. What I am saying is even for the component, for the design of the components, for example, if I have a railway bridge or if I have a road bridge, why can't everything be, maybe it can be a separate part, you know, like in Eurocode, you have a different part of the wind code for loading and the different part for bridges, different for buildings, industrial structures.
There'll be parts only, There should be separate, complete booklet like that.
That's what I also suggested. Same thing, Alok.
Thank you.
Yeah, but if I am designing a railway bridge, I should not completely change my design forces. Then
no,
if I
that's am wrong. Doing that is what we are doing with chimney code. If you refer the chimney code, we have the terrain category alpha values defined there. While the same thing don't have in the basic wind code.
So my suggestion to Dr. Lakshmi for the B2 committee would be to take the loading from IS 875 lock, stock and barrel, and only deal with the design components, design part of the bridges. Response part.
response. So IS 875 part 3 will be one code which is on the load committee, where there can be a new number and there can be part 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 11 for different structural response and designs. It should be like that.
Yeah. Yeah, it should be like that. Yeah.
There is a question from one attendee. When we should go for wind tunnel test and when not? Is there any specific guideline?
That's what I have specified in the flowchart and also explained. Yeah. One can work out like this sort of a susceptibilities there or not can be checked. And then like you can decide whether to go for a wind tunnel test or not.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to close this session here. There are a few more unanswered questions, but probably attendees can send their mail to IASTRACT and we'll surely get the response from the expert speaker, Dr. Lakshmi, and would respond on them. So with that, I would thank IASTRACT. I would thank Dr. Lakshmi for the excellent presentation, very enriching to all the participants. And very nice question answer, Dr. Harshvardhan, Professor Prem Krishna, Alok, everybody contributed. And we are really benefited by all that. So at the end, I would just thank everybody and would request the closure of the session here. Wishing
thank you very much. Thank you very much for all interesting question and make the session lively. Thank you very much.
Excellent.
And I would like to thank both the speaker as well as the moderator, Dr. Abhay Gupta and Dr. Lakshmi, for an excellent treat on the subject. Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you. Vikas, we can close the session. Thank you very much.